This is Ham Radio Now, episode 192, The CW Geek. Going to get into some untrodden territory for KN4AQ. I'm going to talk about Morse code. In fact, back here, there we go. Radio had gone silent on me. This radio is sitting in a uncharacteristic spot in the CW band on 20 meters. So, yes, we are going to be talking about Morse code here on Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, freshly back from the Orlando Hamcation down in Florida, where it was, well, I was kidding Peter, the Hamfest chairman, Peter Myers, about it going down to around freezing. Never quite got to freezing, but getting close to freezing overnight for a couple nights. But it was really pretty darn nice down there. You can see the videos walking around in shirt sleeves during the day anyway. And I should be hardier stock than that. Having grown up in Chicago, where the record low temperature that I saw in my life there was 26 degrees below. Now, that's not wind chill factor. That was real low temperature. That was the record. But just about any given winter in Chicago, we would see a few days where it never got above zero and lows in the minus 5 to minus 10 region. North Carolina, we don't typically see that. Florida was nice. But when I got back to North Carolina, it was reluctant because suddenly we did see Chicago-ish temperatures, not below zero, but a couple of nights where it got down to around 6 or 7 degrees, and daytime highs that didn't break 20. So that was no fun. There's still snow on the ground, just beginning to warm up a little bit, but it's not been a good February. I know it's March. Okay. But it was not a good February. Winter took forever to get here. It was a very mild winter. And then suddenly blam, all because I went to Florida. There's still one more show to come from Florida. Bruce Perrins, K6BP, gave a talk on his Algorand. Not too much different from the one he gave at the Tapper conference, but some new stuff. So we'll have that coming up. But this is going to slip in between this CW Geek program. I want to thank Herb and Lois for a great show. I've been getting lots and lots of positive email from the talk about RVs. Everyone likes that romance of the road. Everybody wants to get on the highway. At least they thought they did. And a phone call from a fan who said he thought he did until he watched that show and said, hey, there's some more things to think about. So, and a lot of good support has been pouring in for the show from that. So thank you very much, which reminds me, Arvin is sitting back there, his nose still out of joint because I left him monitoring this idle studio while I went down to Florida. He's glad we're back. And he says, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the programs, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's icon and help us out. So, CW Geek, this is the guy. It's KB6NU. And this is his blog. If you need a little bit more reading, you might want to stop by his website, kb6nu.com. It's where his blog is. He writes a lot about a lot of different things, but he's a particular CW fan. And the program is going to be about this, a book that he has just released, The CW Geek's Guide to Having Fun with Morse Code. Available in a variety of different formats. And so let's go find out what this is all about. And on my Skype line is Dan. Dan, I don't know how to pronounce your last name.
Well, very few people do. It's pronounced Romanchik.
Romanchik. As right. If like you're romantic, but Romanchik.
Yeah.
Never heard that before, I'll bet.
I never have, no.
All right. And you're on the book tour.
The virtual book tour, yeah.
Suddenly, Ham Radio Now is becoming the the must go to place for authors. I'm getting the authors looking to be on the show. The book in question is this one, the CW Geek's Guide to Fun with Morse Code. So you're a Morse Code guy.
I definitely am. My ham radio email address is cwgeek@kb6nu.com.
Obviously, in this era, no one is required to learn Morse code anymore. And the story I hear, don't know that anyone has verified this with the real numbers, but the story I hear is that Morse code is more popular than ever. Are you finding that to be true?
Well, I don't know if I'd say ever, but it's certainly in the last couple of years.
Well, yeah, okay, we can't say more popular than it was back before there was phone, because then it was right. All there was.
Right.
But the lack of a requirement has not been the death knell of Morse code operation.
Oh, definitely not. Predicted. I mean, you just listen on the bands any night of the week, and you'll hear plenty of Morse code still.
And you were, from reading the couple of the introductory paragraphs in the book, not opposed to the idea of doing away with the rules on Morse code. You were okay with that.
Yeah, I was perfectly fine with that. And because I used to know a lot of guys who would have made great amateur radio operators, but for whatever reason, they either didn't want to take the time to learn Morse code or they just couldn't learn Morse code. So it certainly is not a problem for me.
And so now we are at a point of people can learn it voluntarily, and they are doing that. And so what is the book trying to do for them?
Okay, so what I get a lot is people that are using programs and websites to learn Morse code, and that teaches them the characters, that teaches them the dots and dashes, but it doesn't really teach them how to make Morse code contacts. It doesn't teach them actually how to operate Morse code, and that's really what my book's trying to get at.
It's not a long book. 35 pages. Did I get everything that was in the book?
It's about 50 pages.
Oh, okay. So,
including the appendix, which has about 10 or 15 pages of abbreviations used in cue signals and all that.
Okay, so there's a lot of operating aids and hints and stuff. So we don't want to give away the whole book. We never want to do that in an author interview. But let's try for some tips and techniques, and give people a little tidbit of what they might find in there.
Sure. So like when you're making a Morse code, perfect example of this is the use of punctuation. You know, in Morse code, we don't use the period. So when you come to the end of a sentence, you don't send a period. When you hear someone send a period, you know they're usually an inexperienced operator.
They're a lid.
Instead, inexperienced operator. Lids are people that knowingly or maybe unknowingly but repeatedly do bad things.
Yeah. You know, it actually goes to the origin of that term ham back in the wired telegraphy days. At least one of the stories goes a ham was someone who didn't send very well on the Western Union.
Right. And they were called ham-fisted.
Yeah.
And I love that that explanation the best, actually.
Yeah, nobody knows if that's really the absolute core of it, but it's the one that makes the most sense.
Well, you know where the term lid comes from, don't you?
That I don't know.
Okay. So back in the telegraph days, you only had mechanical sounders, right?
Okay.
And I actually have one of these things.
Yeah, I know where you're going here.
And there's no volume control on those things, right? You've got a brass bar that makes a click, right? So There were a bunch of operators that, and this is a story now, so I don't know the total veracity, but I like the story, is that they would put the lid from a pipe tobacco can behind the sounder, so that the sound would bounce off it and basically amplify the sound. So the people that had to rely on the lid were lids, were not good operators.
We owe so much to the early days of telegraphy.
Oh, actually, absolutely. Even the little bit we use for and, right? The dit, dit, dit.
Yeah.
That's the ampersand in American Morse.
Okay. That is the letters ES.
Right.
Which is another one of those shortcuts you'll find in the appendix to the book.
Right, right, right.
So that's, regular viewers of the program know that I took my 13-word-a-minute test in front of the man in the FCC office in 1965 in Chicago. So I have my bona fides.
Yeah.
But I also have, the way I describe it is, Morse code was never a problem, also never a passion.
Yep.
But
and that's
for
fine.
You, yeah, for you, it's a passion.
Yep.
Maybe the next place we should go is to address the people in the audience who say, well, okay, I got my code-free license. It could be code-free from anywhere from tech to extra now. I think maybe I'll jump into this thing. How do they get started? What's a good way to start learning this thing?
Well, okay. So the first thing you will have to know is the dots and dashes, right? You'll have to learn those sequences. But what my suggestion to people is once they've learned all the letters and numbers and a handful of punctuation, you'll want to know a little bit about the prosigns. Get on the air. Get right on the air. There's several spots in the bands that are I won't say set aside for slow speed operators, but where slow speed operators congregate. And the best practice is to get on the air. You know, I'm on a lot of amateur radio mailing lists, and some of them are CW mailing lists. And you hear these guys say, oh, I got to get up to 15 words a minute before I get on the air, and this and that. And it's like, no, it's much easier to get faster if you get on the air and start making real contacts.
So it's going to be painful and awkward at first.
Right.
You're going to, I remember I was talking with my friend Rich Casey a couple of shows ago about my first couple of days on the air. I showed the logbook from 1965, and the first handful of, I was a novice, they were Morse code contacts, and they were failures, and they were painful. So it's like, you're not going to expect a nice, smooth contact.
No, and the guys like me who are going to talk to guys like you, I'll do this a lot. I'll tune around looking for people that are sending very slowly, and I'll work them. And I don't expect them to be perfect. Hey, we're amateurs. We're not professionals.
and Morse code has been called the gentleman's mode, and right? You kind of expect that attitude, but you're not going to find it from everybody. So you might encounter some people that. They won't slow down for you, or they won't give you a break. They'll just go away.
And my take on that is, don't bother. I mean, don't worry about that. Just don't bother with them.
Yeah, I'm grabbing my operating aid here. We should remind the folks that have a tech license that they can operate on several HF bands.
That's right.
But with Morse code only.
Right.
Got a little slice of 80 meters.
Yep.
A pretty big slice of 40 meters.
Yep.
And a pretty big slice of 15 meters in the Morse code band.
And all of 10 meters. The whole CW section of 10 meters as well.
Yeah. So from 28.0 to 28.3 where the phone band begins, and you can operate Morse down there. And it's just a code, right? They don't get the data modes down there.
I think on 10 meters they do actually get data, but I'm not certain of that.
I'd have to interpret the chart that I'm looking at a little better than I can. For some reason, these things are hard to do when I'm staring at the camera. So
yeah. The ARRL has come out with a new sort of survey. They're interested in changing the band plan to allow novices and techs more data privileges, even on 80 meters and 15 meters.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that survey that's going on from several perspectives, and I guess now will be a good time to do it. I don't know if we've exhausted the idea of how to tiptoe into getting on the air. We'll come back to that. as long as you're talking about the survey, I don't have that up here on. I guess I can probably find it pretty quickly on the web. But the league is looking for thoughts from their members on changing the band plan. And let me see, what have we got here? It may have already floated off of their homepage.
Yeah, possibly.
Looks like it did. Well, we'll do the read all and see what comes up. Oh, no, I don't think. this is hard. Yeah. running the web and running a TV show all by myself is hard. So let's just talk about it a little bit. What are, from a CW operator's perspective, how are, and then first of all, this is voluntary. This is not right. The FCC telling people what to do. It's the FCC tells you certain modes in this part of the band, certain modes in that part of the band.
Right.
That's about it. This is all the voluntary stuff. Do people pay attention to that?
They do down in the lower part of the band. Yeah. You rarely hear any digital, for example, outside like 14065 to 14100. You know, in the 20-meter band, that's pretty much it. 40 meters is a little bit weirder because the 40 meters is a little bit weirder because the designated frequency for data is like between 7035 and 7040. So you still see here a little bit of a mix of CW and data in that little range. And of course, when there's a teletype contest, all bets are off. But I know that's crazy. But there isn't a lot of interference between the modes, so I don't think that's going to be too big of a problem.
There are CW operators that are worried about data.
Yeah, and you know there was a big flap for a while about these automatic email stations, the Winmore and the Pactor stations, but you know I don't think that's really panned out. Maybe you have a different viewpoint on that, but I mean you don't hear about a lot of interference between those automatic stations and, you know, data or CW stations. So I don't think this is going to be a big problem.
Yeah, I haven't heard a lot about it at all, other than the occasional blow up on QRZ.com.
Yeah.
It seems like the panic is, you know, a little bit of sky is falling, as right. opposed to here's what's really happening. There's probably been some interference. But in terms of what's going on in that part of the band, I guess the big deal is data modes versus CW modes. And the argument that I hear is that if a data signal appears and starts causing interference, you can't interrupt them and say, excuse me, you're causing me a problem. They're not listening for Morse code.
That's right. And that happens, but I don't think it's that big of a problem.
Yeah. The other thing that I know that happens within what for US hams is the CW part of the band is in the rest of the world, phone operates down there. What I've heard is that other countries don't have any designation between phone and CW. They can right. put phone any place. So
right. And again, that's usually not a big problem either. Sometimes on 40 meters, you know, you hear the Sirius phone or, you know, between 7055 and 7065, but usually the signals are weak enough that that's not a big problem.
And they tend to stay near the top end of the American CW band.
Yeah, I oddly enough, on 40 meters last night, I heard of some CW or some phone down around 7015, but that's extremely rare. That's just extremely rare. So again, I don't think that's going to be a problem.
Okay, so people generally voluntarily isolate or segregate themselves to different parts of the band where it tends to work.
Right, and you know it makes sense, right? Because if you're a phone station, you're going to want to go where the phone stations are so you can contact them. And generally, that's not going to be in the CW portion of the bands.
All right, and I guess we should also remind technicians that if you're going to operate Morse code on the HF bands with a tech license or a general license, that the bottom 25 kilohertz of almost every band is for extras only.
Well, for 80, careful. 40, 20, and 15.
Yeah.
The other, like 30 meters.
Oh, 30 meters doesn't?
No, there's no extra class portion of 30 yep. meters. And I don't believe any of the other WARC bands have an extra class portion.
That's true. 17 doesn't, and 12 doesn't, and 10 doesn't. So, right. yeah. So just the ones everybody wants to be on.
Well, good point. So, but maybe yes and no. 30 meters is a great CW band. Great CW band for a couple of reasons. First off, it stays open a little bit longer than 20 meters. And second, worldwide, the power limit on 30 meters is 200 watts. So it's a little bit more of a level playing field.
Yeah, 30 meters is a very narrow band. It's only, well, it's 10.1 to 10.15, so it's only 40 kilohertz wide.
Right.
And there's no phone on it at all.
Right. And it's beautiful. I love 30 meters.
Yeah.
And you can operate data up at the top. So the CW guys are down at the bottom between 10.110 and 10.125, and the digital guys are up near the top.
Yeah, and that's also all voluntary, according to the chart.
Right.
But I'm looking at here, and there's the 30 meters up there, and it's all one solid color. So it's it's us deciding what we want to do. And
right.
It sounds like it works pretty well. Which means, of course, I don't end up on 30 very much.
Well, you can operate digital there. I don't know if you do digital, but you know, there's some
In a while. I should. Spectrum-wise and propagation-wise, it falls in between 40 and 20 meters.
Right.
Very desirable spot.
Right. That's why I say it stays open a little bit longer than 20. And then at night, you get really nice propagation. From here where I'm in Michigan, I regularly work Europe on 30 meters. And they boom in.
Yeah. All right. So back to our code-free ham who wants to get started with Morse code. The book is not a tutorial on learning Morse code. It's got a lot of information on what it's going to be like and what you should do. And I think you point people to some places to go for tutorials. But do you have a real favorite on
Right. So what I usually recommend is the G4FON CW Trainer course. That's a really good program, and people I know have had some good success with it. There's a website that uses the same approach, the quote-unquote Koch method or Cook method, K-O-C-H is however you pronounce that German word. And that's the G4FON program, and they're both very good. Some people learn a little bit differently, might want to try the K7QO code course. That is a series of MP3 files that comes on a CD-ROM, and it uses a totally different method. But K7QO is another real CW geek. I hope he doesn't mind me saying that. His code course has been quite effective too for lots of people. So those are the three things I usually recommend.
Something that occurred to me just the other day, now that we don't have a test to take anymore, there's no reason to learn how to write things down. And in your book, you get to the point where you say stop writing because it's going to slow you down.
That's right.
You're not going to write fast enough. But what about the idea of not writing at all, ever, from the beginning?
You know, the G4FON program kind of requires you to do that, because the way the method works is it starts you out with two characters, K and M, and then you have to you copy those two characters till you get it 90% right, and then you move on to the third character. Well, if you don't kind of write it down or type it on a computer, you never know if you get to 90%. And, you know, you could eyeball it, I think. I mean, you know, sort of say, okay, I'm about 90%. I'm going to start the third character. But, you know, there's that, you know. You really want, at some point with this method, you want to know how well you're doing. But other than that, I would say, sure, you know. When I got back in the ham, I'm a ham for a long time, but I really only got back in the ham radio about 12 or 13 years ago. And when I did, I was writing code down, you know, on paper and all. And I was about 15, 16 words a minute. And I read somewhere that, you know, really to get faster, you have to start copying your head. And I just went cold turkey. I said, okay, I'm not copying anymore. And I didn't. And I did get faster. So that's why I tell people to do that. That's really the best advice I ever got.
Yeah, so I guess I can see the problem of learning without writing anything down from the beginning is because how do you know you've actually learned anything?
Right.
but if you listen to real speech, I suppose you're going to know, yeah, I'm getting words.
Yeah, and the W1AW code practice, for example, they're sending text from their articles. So if you're understanding what they're sending, then you have a good idea that you're learning it, right?
Yeah, when you're down at 3 or 4 words a minute as you're just getting started, 5 words a minute, it is so tedious that you probably are forgetting the letters that have gone by before you can start putting together words.
Yeah, that's another thing.
Yeah, so yeah. I don't know if that's going to be possible. But I was talking to my friend Jeff, AC4ZO, who is a CW guy, at dinner the other night. And the point that we came up with for the folks that thought that a Morse code requirement was a good idea was that a Morse code requirement in the test meant you had to be able to write things down.
Right.
And that slowed things down, so it was ultimately counterproductive in terms of doing good Morse code. So,
take that, you guys.
I don't know if there's any of them left.
Well, of course, in the military, right? When they taught people to copy Morse code, they were copying Morse code because they were actually passing messages. Yeah. And that's an activity where you do want to write it down, right?
Yes.
So, but in general, you don't. And in contesting too. Contesting, you have to write it down or at least type it in. And so there is some value to still being able to copy, you know, producing a hard copy.
Yeah, and probably starting right on a computer.
Yeah,
the military would have been on a typewriter.
Right.
Back in the day.
Right.
And today you're going to be typing it into your logging program for contesting anyway.
So right.
You might as well, assuming you can touch type, if you're hunt and peck typing, and I'm not sure anybody alive today only hunts and pecks.
Oh, my wife still does.
Oh, dear.
She won't see the show, so I can get away with that.
Okay. So, but if you know touch typing, which, you know, I learned touch typing back in 7th or 8th grade, but at that time we were not required to learn the number row. And so I never did.
Oh,
and I keep trying to teach myself the number row, and it never happens. I got to look down when it's time to do numbers.
That's interesting. Yeah, I learned it in high school, and we did numbers. Sometimes I joke that that's the most useful thing they taught me in high school.
Absolutely. I totally agree. The most useful, actually, or at least a physical skill,
yeah,
was learning to type. And I'm glad I got it in junior high. So just get on the air. Learn enough Morse code to get on the air, and then get on the air. I guess that takes putting together a station that will actually get on the air.
Well, right.
Is there a band you would start with?
Well, 40 meters, I think, is the best one, because it's, like they say, 40 meters is open almost all the time to somewhere.
Yeah.
And the guys that, you know, get on 10 meters and say, well, I'm going to operate sideband on 10 meters. Well, that's catch as catch can. But 40 meters is open most of the time to somewhere. And in a way, it's better than 80 meters because the antennas are half as long, right? You know, you can fit a 40 meter antenna in a lot smaller lot than you can an 80 meter antenna.
Yeah. And if you're going to put up a dipole, 40 meter dipole, and feed it with coax, you know, make it a resonant dipole, which is something that Bob Heil's a big fan of. Something that I'm not such a big fan of. I'd much rather. I need my wide shot. Where's my wide shot? I've lost my wide shot. Ah, there we go. There's my twin lead coming in from the window.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a big fan of non-resonant dipoles fed with twin lead, and then the tuner. You see the tuner sitting on the back there. Yeah. But Bob Heil's a big fan of resonant antennas. And so if you put up a resonant dipole fed with coax on 40 meters, you get a bonus band. You get 15 meters.
That's right.
There's a CW band for you techs on 15 as well. So that's a good start.
Back in the old days, if you remember, right, there's always the articles about the novice special antenna, right, which was a 40-meter dipole that you also used on 15.
All right, so are there any bad habits that you find people fall into right away that you could avoid?
I don't know about right away, but one thing that's happening on the bands, which I don't like, is people are starting to fall into contest mode or DX mode, even when you're just rag chewing. You know, like I'll be calling CQ and some guy will just send his call and he'll only send it once. And it's like, nah, you know, I just don't like that. In fact, when somebody does that to me, I always send QRZ, meaning who's calling me. I make him send my call. And the reason it's bad practice is it could be that he's not actually calling me. And so you always want to send the calling station's call once or twice before you start sending your call. And then you want to repeat your call once or twice, depending on band conditions.
Yeah,
because not everybody gets it right off the bat.
Yeah, and you're saying that is for general conversation, not for contests, not for DX.
Yeah. In contests, you want to do things faster, so you only send it once. And same with DX, you send it once or twice, and if they don't copy it on the first or second call, the third call is not going to magically make them hear you.
So, what kind of conversation can you have when you're beginning and your code speed is slow? We'll talk about fast speed in a minute, but
yeah.
When you're slow, can you enjoy it, or do you have a treadmill for a while?
Well, I think you do enjoy it. You don't enjoy it in quite the same way. The usual protocol is to send a signal report, your name and location on the first transmission, and then on the second transmission, you usually send some information about your rig and maybe the weather, although I don't like talking about the weather unless it's some unusual weather event. But I still think that that's fun, even at slow speeds. I mean, like I said, I'll talk to guys at slow speed if that's what it takes. So I think that's still okay. I mean, you're not going to talk about existentialism 15 words a minute, but
Yeah, well, we could talk about the general problem on both CW and phone of more interesting conversations, but
it's the same on phone too, actually.
Yeah, but CW has tended to a very ritualized contact, at least to begin with, and then
right.
If you're not, something's not clicking or things are very slow, it's name, location, weather, rig, antenna, 73.
Yeah.
But
there's ways around that, right? Like I have a computer in my shack. One of the first things I do when I make contact with a guy is call up their QRZ.com page. QRZ.com page, if they filled it out, we'll have some interesting information about them and something I can ask them about.
You can do that while you're having a Morse code contact?
Oh, yeah, sure.
You're good.
I Twitter while I'm having a Morse code contact sometimes.
Let me dig up QRZ.com, and it is, let's see, I got to log in to really see you here. My login has been successful. Hooray. KB6NU. So at some point you were in California, it sounds like.
Yeah, I'm actually a Detroit native, so the call sign is a little misleading. But after college, I went out and worked out in California for a while. I joke I couldn't take the perfect weather, so I had to move back to Michigan.
So I don't know if you've watched Ham Radio Now enough to know, but then we are both Detroiters.
Oh,
or at least Michiganders, because cool. I was born in Detroit.
Okay, and west side or east side?
Well, actually, where I was born, I don't know. Where I lived for the first 8 years of my life was on 8 Mile Road right across from Oak Park.
Oh, okay. So that's west side.
Yeah, northwest. Just a little near Woodward someplace. When you're eight and earlier, you don't know the streets beyond two blocks away from your house.
Well, anything west of 8 Mile is the west side, or anything west of Woodward. Anything east of Woodward is an east sider.
So
I'm an Eastsider.
Welcome to Ham Radio in Detroit. and for four more years, moved over to Southfield, which is just down the road from where we were. So I know it's kind of northwest. And that was back in the 1950s. But it was where my interest in, I almost feel bad saying in electronics, because I've never been an engineer, never been good at pure electronics. But my interest in communications was all born there.
Sure.
Friend of mine and I... at age 10, 11 or so, we were two houses apart, strang wire stealthily one night through the backyard of the in-between neighbor and hooked up an intercom system. And hearing his voice come out of that was just the coolest thing.
Yeah.
And of course, it eventually led to radio. So so you've gotten started and you're at least enjoying your Morse code contacts enough that you're going to keep on going. When does it really get fun? When does it just everything suddenly become smooth sailing?
Well, I think it's fun all along. I mean, it's all a journey, right?
Yeah.
But to be able to have good conversations, you probably want to get up to 20 words a minute. You know, that's a good goal for that. And this is why I included in the book. It's the proper use of cue signals and abbreviations, because that makes the communication that much more efficient.
It would. I was thinking as I was reading the book, 20 words a minute, 25, 30 words a minute. Can I simulate that with speech? And how fast would a spoken conversation? It's kind of like this. How fast would a spoken conversation be? It's the old Saturday Night Live slow talkers.
But that's supposedly what, simulating of 20 words a minute?
Approximately, yeah.
Okay.
I didn't calibrate it very well.
Yeah. But like I say, when you start using the abbreviations properly and the cue signals properly, that speeds it up. A cue signal is a whole phrase in three characters.
Yeah. So it does help speed things up a lot. What speed do you have you achieved, and where do you find you're able to carry on good conversations? Do you even bother with the actual speed number anymore?
Well, I still like to keep track of that. You know, I'm one of those guys. But I can do 30 words per minute pretty well. And if the band conditions are right and the other operator's fist is good, I can do 35 to 40 maybe. And in contests, contests are faster too.
Yeah, contests are a little bit different animal. And you talk about that in the book.
Right.
But because of routine.
Right, and that's why I suggest people operate contests. Again, even if they're slower, there's some slower speed contests, and because that helps them, that is more practice, and it helps them get faster.
Yeah, again, my friend Jeff likes to point out in contests that you can clip right along, and the guy you're talking to can clip right along as long as nobody deviates from the formula.
Right.
As soon as somebody says, as soon as he sends something that the other station is not expecting, they're gone.
Right. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean don't do it. That means go ahead. And if someone does send you something at that top rate of speed that is out of the format, just turn the keyer down a little bit and go da-da-da-da, did it.
Yeah, absolutely.
If they're a good operator, a considerate operator, they'll try it again.
That's right.
And he probably knew just what he was doing. He probably knew he was going to flummox you.
And the thing in contests is they want your contact as much as you want their contact. So if they really, they'll slow down, because they want to get your points.
Good point. All right, so you can clip along at 30 to maybe 40 if somebody's pretty good. What qualifies as pretty good? Are you talking about machine sent code?
Well, I mean, sometimes you can tell if it's machine sent, but just good spacing. Good spacing is the crucial thing in CW. Maybe you haven't heard it because you don't operate CW that much, but the thing that bugs me the most is guys that run their characters together, because then you can't tell. Where the character one character ends and another starts.
Well, tell you what, we can simulate that, because I have behind me my HF station. Evidently, I've tuned in something a little bit awkward here, and I've got a camera on it. Are you able to hear that?
No, I can't hear it.
I'm not sending it to you? Oh, yeah. I think I'm sending it to you now.
Yeah, I can hear it now.
So that guy's fairly slow.
And he has a very nice spacing.
In fact, it may be a little bit extra long, but not too bad.
Yeah. And if you're going real fast, that little bit of extra space between the characters is good.
Yeah. So I can this is going to really seriously challenge my ability to do television. And
is this a first for you, sending Morse code to add in your television show?
Yes, it'll be a first sending Morse code and also trying to get back here to the station. What I'm going to do is just turn the RF gain down. I've got the radio set with the break-in turned off. So right. I can send on my paddle without actually sending anything on the air.
Right. So
an example of, the microphone boom right in the way. An example of sending something without the right spacing would be. So that would be KM4AQ all run together, which no one is going to be able to copy. So. Oops. It's iambic is getting me.
Yeah.
So I'm proving that I'm, you know, pretty much not very good at this stuff.
All you're proving is that you need more practice.
Well, yes, need lots more practice. Let's listen to a few guys on the air here and see what we think about some of these guys here. Turn the RF gain back up. We're on 20 meters. That was a guy we heard before. Let's go down into the X-tree band and hear some of these fast guys. Where are they? I believe we hear an example of someone who's not really leaving enough space.
Yeah, like his name is Pietro, right? P-I-E-T-R-O. And that T in the R almost sounded like a C.
See, 007J?
Yeah. That guy's pretty good.
Where's 007?
I think that's Belgium. O-N-O-O.
Ah. Okay.
See, you know more than you're letting on.
Yes. I still hang on to about 12, 13 words a minute. Oops, we're out of the band. Okay, so up to 25 is the extra band, and so we're going to start seeing more signals above 25. KD4ESO. So that sounds pretty good.
Yep.
And that's probably going about, what, 15?
Yeah, maybe a little faster.
All right. So you got tips in the book on how to set up stuff and operate. And again, I don't want to make you disclose everything that's in the book, but
doesn't matter to me.
I forgot where I want to turn that down. I want to turn it down on my mixer, not down on the radio. Well, when you're operating in the code band, some things that I don't know the answers to, there's plenty. They would fill a book. But how close to the edge of the band or a sub-band that you're allowed to operate can you get?
Well, the general rule of thumb is 500 hertz.
Okay. And that's assuming that your radio has good calibration and you know really know where you are, plus or minus 15 hertz or so.
Yeah, yeah. If you're, you know, you want to make sure you're using a digitally synthesized radio.
Yep. So again, if we were looking at this radio, gotta slide my microphone back here again. The lowest as an extra that I would want to see would be 14 about there. 14.00.5.
Yeah, you might cheat a little bit farther down, but you know, and if you want to really be sure.
Yep. And different radios operate differently, but I believe on this radio, when I send a signal, it is going to be right on that frequency, not offset.
For CW, sure.
Yeah, not offset anyplace.
Right.
So, remember all the buttons to push. And just to make things a little bit more complicated, I now have the bear in my lap. He said, yeah, Dad, clearly you need help to handle this. Okay, so 500 hertz or so. In theory, and probably not even correctly in theory, CW is sort of a zero bandwidth mode. Once you start actually keying, and assuming you've got a clean transmitter that isn't sending out key clicks and junk, you start using up some bandwidth.
Oh, yeah, sure.
But how, outside of contests, outside of DX, where everyone piles on top of each other and interference is not an issue, how close across the band should people stack themselves up? You hear somebody operating on a frequency and you want to call CQ, how close should you get to him?
Right. I try to stay a kilohertz away from the other operators. You know, some of the books will say, well, you know, you can get down to 500 hertz. And, yeah, you probably can if the other guy's got good filtering in his radio, but, you know, he may not. Or, you know, a lot of guys start using vintage equipment. I worked a guy yesterday who was using a Heathkit SB-102. Yeah, I know. So you know, you don't know what kind of filtering those guys have. So, if you know, it's not like we need to be crammed in that closely. So I try to stay a kilohertz away from other operators.
And that filtering thing is, I guess it's the key to this question.
Because
with sideband, your signal is going to be about 2.5 kilohertz to 3 kilohertz wide, no matter what. With CW, your width is pretty close to zero. And so it's what the guy on the receiving end is able to differentiate that becomes the limiting factor, and you don't know what that is.
Right. So, you know, that ICOM you have, you can get it down pretty narrow and still copy the other station. You could get it down to 100 kilohertz or 100 hertz and still copy. You know, the tone at 100 hertz probably may not be the most pleasing, but you won't hear the interference. But again, like I say, some guys don't have that capability, so I try to stay as far away as I can. Okay. Yeah, and then the other thing is I actually like to operate with as wide a bandwidth as possible. Not so much especially when you're in a contest or something, because you want to hear what's going on around you. You know, if you're locked in to having a rag chew with somebody, turn the filters as closely as you want or can, because then you really only want to hear that one station. But in a contest, you want to hear what's going on around you.
Let's see what that actually looks and sounds like. So I've tuned in this guy, and the filter currently is at 1.2 kilohertz.
Mm-hmm.
Let me see if I can tune in somebody that has got somebody right next to him. Everyone's got themselves too well spaced out for this demonstration.
See that? We're good operators in the CW Porsche.
Yep. But the built-in filters, ready-to-go filters, I'll push the filter button, the next one is 500 hertz. And if I shut up, you'll hear the difference in the background noise. Now, here's the 1.2 kilohertz. He's so strong, we're not hearing much background noise anyway, but...
Yeah, that's actually another reason to use as narrow a filter as possible if you're in a noisy environment. That filtering will eliminate some of that noise.
Yeah. And, of course, he stops just as I'm getting things going. It's a little harder to tune in with a narrow filter because you're going to get past somebody.
Exactly. That's another reason I like a wider filter. And, you know, especially if you're calling CQ, you know, and some people don't always come back to you right on your frequency. If your passband is a little wider, you can sometimes catch people calling you a little bit off frequency that you wouldn't if your filter was narrower.
All right. So the other thing that some of the old timers tell me about is that the absolute best filter is the one that is in between the headphones.
Yeah. Once you operate more, you do the audio filtering right in your head. You can ignore something that's off frequency or listen to something that's off frequency.
Yeah, because the old radios, they didn't have filters that narrow. They might have a single notch filter that you can sort of get in there and make one signal go away.
Right.
But they didn't have 500 hertz filters. And if they did, the filter was so bad that it had something called a ringing.
Yeah.
Which is just kind of, it made its own tone at the frequency you were trying to hear the CW guy at. So it's kind of like, This radio doesn't do that. The newer radios don't do that. 200 hertz filter just takes you right on down there.
Yeah, I know. These are beautiful. The DSP is, DSP, it's sort of ironic, right? DSP has made operating CW that much more pleasurable.
And phone, but probably, probably does more for CW because it can really isolate that narrow signal.
And the notch filter is great. Notch filter, you know, if somebody comes on frequency real close to you, that notch filter, you can just notch them right out, and it's wonderful.
Should we show people what that looks and sounds like? I guess
if you can.
I think I can. it's a little engine that could. I think I can. So I'm going to turn on the notch.
Yeah, see, notch that guy right out. It's very good. It's very really nice function.
Now you can't really use an automatic notch filter on CW because it's going to take out the guy you want to hear.
Yeah, and they're closer together too. I think that confuses the automatic notch filtering function.
Yep.
Yeah, it's all software.
Yeah. So again, couldn't tune in in any contacts where people were all clustered together near one frequency. I guess if I could find a DX pileup or something, I could.
If we were doing this during a contest.
Yeah. Where do you stand on computerized sending and computerized receiving?
Hey, if it gets guys on CW, I'm all for it. You know, especially, I've worked a couple of guys who were using computer keyboards. And what they said to me is, they said, you know, I wish I could use a key, but my arthritis is so bad I can't use a key anymore. And in that case, to me, it's like beautiful. I wouldn't have made that contact if he wasn't able to use a computer keyboard.
Yep. But he was probably copying, either writing down or copying in his head.
I would guess so, yeah.
And doing the receiving in his head, which is the hard side of things. Although sending is more of an art than you might think when everyone says it's so easy to send. You know, sending is the easy part.
Sending is not. Yeah, I'll give you another example. Once you get up to like 35 or 40 words a minute, it's actually almost harder to send than it is to receive, because the hand, your hand has to be so fast that sometimes it's harder to send than it is to receive.
It's kind of
an amusing thing.
Do you recommend that people start immediately with electronic keyer? Or should people learn the old, I don't even have a straight key here in the shack.
That's what I recommend to people is that start with a paddle and keyer, and I get criticized for that all the time, but that's just my opinion. And the reason I have two reasons for that. One is you'll send better code right off because the keyer is doing the spacing of the timing of the dots and the dashes, and B, your arm will get less tired, and you'll stick with it more, right? I mean, you don't do things that hurt, right? And if you're gonna, you know, really be a CW operator, you have to practice, and it's much easier to send with a paddle and keyer.
Yeah, I don't think you want to send for a long time with a straight key.
No,
because
I can't. Yeah. Like straight key night, 30 minutes, 40 minutes maybe is my max. I got to take a break.
I was going to ask you about straight key night. What'd you do?
Oh, yeah. Well, I have straight keys. I got a bunch of straight keys. In fact, I have a couple of really cool straight keys. I have what's called a Bunnell number 9, which is a very cool key. I should have had it with me here. And then I have a J37 key.
Not a J38.
Not a J38. It's a J37 with a leg clamp. And apparently guys use these in Jeeps and in planes, and you know, there's no place to put a key there, right? So there's this clamp that fits over your leg, and that's the you use your leg basically as the platform for the key.
I wonder if I can come up with a picture of that. Let me J 37 key. We'll see what happens. And we'll try Google Images. Put it on the screen, and there we go.
Yeah, there you go. and the other thing about this key is the guys in World War II must have had a lot smaller legs than what I have. Because that we're talking about the arm hurting. After about 20 or 30 minutes with that on my leg, it's like cutting off my circulation. That's terrible. But it's a nice key. And the interesting thing about this key is it doesn't have a spring in there. Like the J38 has a spring underneath the knob controlling the tension. There's actually a sort of a leaf spring, and that's what gives you the tension.
Because you still need tension, otherwise it'll just stay keyed.
Right.
Unless you're holding
but
it
up. But it's not a spring. It's sort of a leaf spring, if you will.
So it's a better feel to it?
Well, it's just kind of a different design. I guess it could be considered a different feel.
The guys who can send Morse code while driving, while operating other stuff, the guys who can carry on a Morse code contact and talk to you in the room at the same time are legendary. Can you do that?
You know, I can copy if it's slow enough and talk to somebody at the same time, but I can't send and talk at the same time.
So that is sort of like the epitome. That's the peak capability. That's not the goal for everybody.
Here in Ann Arbor, there used to be a store called Purchase Radio, and the guy who owned it, named Roy Purchase, his call sign was W8RP, and he was noted for being able to do that. He was noted to be able to take care of a customer and copy code in the background at the same time.
Yeah, I've got an interview with a ham in California that I recorded several years ago. And I haven't put it on the air yet just because I haven't gotten around to editing. It's a long talk. But it's one of those guys. And he starts by having a code conversation going on while we're doing the Ham Radio Now interviews. I'll dig that up. I got to get that on there. As much as you're interested in Morse code and stuff, that is not the only thing that you do as a prolific author. You've also got these... study guides. No-nonsense study guides. What is no-nonsense about a no-nonsense study guide?
Okay, so I focus, and I get criticized for this too, I focus in on basically teaching people the answers to the questions, but I give them enough context so that they get a little bit better understanding than if they just read the question pool. So I try to filter out the nonsense, but yet give them enough context to get them a good start in the hobby. Does that make any sense?
Well, yeah. Learning stuff for a license test is kind of tedious. For someone who doesn't know electronics theory to begin with, not deep in communications, and this was. The license tests were never a big problem for me, although I did fail my general test the first time. I passed my advanced and extra tests, evidently with enough studying to get them the first time. And the advanced, once again, downtown Chicago in front of the man.
Yeah, yeah.
I
took mine in San Francisco.
Yeah, I did my extra in front of the VEs. The Laurel
Same
VEs
year.
Didn't cost me anything. On that magic April 15th, 2000, when you took the written test with a 13-word a minute or even a 5-word a minute code proficiency. You took the written test for the extra ahead of the 15th, but didn't turn in the CSCE until afterwards because on the 15th, the Morse code requirement dropped for the extra from 20 to 5 words a minute. So I never had to learn the 20. I was close. My friend Jeff again said I was he watched me copy. He said, "You're solid at 18, and you're proficient enough at 20 that with a couple hours of practice, you could pass that." But I was evidently too lazy. By the way, the bear is still here, so that's what's going on down.
That's a cute guy
down by my lap.
I have a funny story about the code test. If you want to hear,
yeah, oh yeah.
When the code test was 5 words per minute, one of my friends took the test, and what he did was he just wrote down the dots and the dashes. And after they finished sending, he went back and decoded it. And
I've heard of people trying to do that.
Yeah, yeah. He actually did it.
If they give you time.
and they didn't give him the certificate right away because they wanted to check with the ARRL to make sure that was okay. And as it turned out, it was okay. So that shows you how dumb those 5 words per minute tests were. I mean, there was no Morse code proficiency there at all, really.
Yeah, when I took my novice, of course, the original novices were essentially VEs.
Right.
It took two hams to give the test. We didn't call them VEs back then, but it was pretty much it. The bear is biting my fingers. Getting a little painful. when I took the test in front of the FCC, the 13 word a minute test, they finished the test and grabbed your paper. You had no time to, you couldn't do any shenanigans like that.
So you had to
do it right the first time. Back to the study guides. You got ARRL, which is, you know, they're going back and forth on calling it the license manual. It's back to being the license manual again.
Right.
And that is pretty straightforward. Here is the technology, but they're trying to teach you something of the engineering of the electronics behind it. Not just the Q&A rote memorization. Gordon West, I haven't seen one of his guides in a long time, but he tries to make it more fun.
Right.
And so you're kind of somewhere in the middle. You're not trying to teach electronics.
Right. I'm just trying to set the basis for them. So my point of view is that no matter how long you go to class, you're not, I mean, obviously you can't learn electronics in 8 weeks or 12 weeks, you know, it's a traditional novice technician class course. You know, I went to school for electrical engineering. It took me 4 years to get through. You know,
and these days, they're not 8 weeks or 12 weeks. They're a day.
Well, yeah, that's why I teach ham in a day class myself. So what I try to do is just teach them enough so that they pass the test. And then, but I always stress that the learning starts after you pass the test.
Yeah.
I mean, you and I have been hams a long time. We're still learning, right?
I stopped a while ago because it got too painful, but...
you're still learning.
I'm still learning,
You're still learning.
I'm learning right this
minute. Because you're still in it.
Yeah.
If you weren't still learning, you wouldn't still be in ham radio.
Yeah, because the getting on the air and talking is not the most important thing. To me,
absolutely.
Probably not to you and to most hams. It's absolutely fun. But if we all got on the air and spent 2 hours a day talking, the bands would be overrun, every one of them, and repeaters would be impossible to use.
Right.
So most of us do something else. We listen a lot, but we're interested in other things.
Right.
So
that's what I do with the study guides is that I just try to set the stage for it.
Yeah, and everything you got is at your website, which I keep forgetting that I've got a lot of audio listeners. So it's KB6NU, Kilo Bravo 6, November Uniform.com. And that's where the book is available, the Fun with Morse Code and the study guides. Let's see.
I have another one there that people might be interested in.
Oh,
it's
sure.
21 things to do after you get your amateur radio license. And so after getting so many people their licenses, they said to me, well, you know, now what do I do? Well, that's what this book says. And it doesn't go into real depth on anything, but it lists 21 different things that I think they should do after they get their ham radio license. You know, go to a ham fest, join the ARRL, join your local club, build an antenna. You know, it's just basic stuff like that.
And that is, as I understand it, that is a thing. We are getting people passing their test, getting their license, and then not getting on the air.
Right.
I never considered anything like that. Getting on the air was the most important, desperately important thing to me at that time, but evidently not so much anymore.
You know, I just don't understand that. You know, people, I teach a lot of classes, and a lot of people in from my classes do that. And it's like, you know, geez, what does it take, you know? What does it take to get them to be ham radio operators? So I don't know. And I think what happens is, you know, people always had this idea they wanted to have a ham radio license. They get the license, and then they realize the time it takes. And it does take a lot. Ham radio takes a lot of time, right?
It can.
And it can. And especially when you're just learning. And they just kind of get a little bit overwhelmed by it. And so they, you know, a lot of them will even buy handhelds and play around with the handheld for a while. But you can only do so much with a handheld.
Yeah, I mean, ham radio is a good ticket with you, handhelds and mobile. If you've got a long commute, you can listen to NPR. You could listen to Chuck and Bobby in the morning, or you can talk on the local repeaters and talk to Chuck and Bobby in the morning. So we all can participate in it in our own ways. This station behind me, I write off on my income tax because it spends more time in the background of ham radio now as a set than it does as an operating ham station. And that's kind of sad to admit. In fact, the 10 transistor base station, you know, that almost never gets on the airs. Don't know if you recognize that.
No, I didn't.
The 10 transistor base station. That's an old Sears CB.
Oh, okay.
From back in the 50s and early 60s.
Yeah.
So it belonged to a young fellow who would have been my brother-in-law, Cindy's brother. He passed away when he was a teenager. So his folks kept it around for a long time, and it now occupies a place of honor on the shelf on my ham shack. Because I remember it from back in the days.
Sure.
So, 21 things to do, and you mentioned a couple of those. So we'll get people doing all that stuff. And I should mention that these books are available in a variety of formats. Like the 21 things is Kindle, Nook, PDF, and the Fun with Morse Code, all the same way. $3 for most of those. You can get them as printed books, but you're going to spend a bit more, like $8 for them.
Well, the CW book is the only one that's actually available in print version now.
Okay.
Although I'm going to have the tech study guide available in print really shortly. And I was just working on the 21 things today, actually. A club in Michigan here asked if they could print off a bunch. And I said, well, I probably should make that available as a print version. And I found out that it's much easier to do than I thought. And I should have been doing this all along. But using Amazon's Create Space tools, it's really not too tough to make a print version.
They print one on demand. They don't print 10,000 copies and have them gathered up on a warehouse shelf until they get bought.
Right. So I'm going to make print versions. I'm going to have a bunch printed up, and I'm going to take them to Dayton with me. So I'll have them in Dayton.
Ah, an autographed.
They can get an autograph first.
Yeah. So
if they want them, I'll autograph.
But that's why those are more expensive, because there's
no extra charge.
No, but the print version is several bucks more expensive than the PDF or Kindle or whatever.
Just because you got to handle it's a material. You got to handle the material.
Yeah. The costs for getting that done. There was one other thing that I noticed. It wasn't on your website anyplace. It was in your email. You're the chief operator for a museum station.
Right. So WA2HOM is the radio station at the Ann Arbor Hands-On Museum. A2, here in Ann Arbor, we sometimes call Ann Arbor A squared. So that's where the A2 comes from. And HOM, obviously, is Hands-On Museum. That came about because I'm a member of the local Rotary
at this
Club.
Here.
I'm a member of the local Rotary Club. And the executive director of this museum is also a member. And one of the first meetings I was at, he spoke about the Hands-On Museum. And a light went off in my head saying, hey, this is a place for an amateur radio station. And we've had one there for 7 or 8 years now.
Let's see. Are there any pictures here on the website?
You know, I don't know if I have too many. I'm not a very good photographer.
Let's see. We've got an about here.
Yeah, that's...
Only Hamlet, who is evidently... Yeah. If you look on the shelf behind me, that's that guy back there. His name is Arvin.
There you go.
Which was taken from the original name of my network, Amateur Radio Video News, ARVN. So he's Arvin. Yeah. He's our chief financial officer. I'll stick in a plug here in the middle. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, if you like, you know, looking at guys like Ken, then stop by hamradionow.tv. There's the website right there. Hamradionow.tv. You'll see Arvin's picture and you can help contribute to keep all of this vast array. Now this, where'd the vast array go? I've lost my picture of the vast array. There we go. The vast array of television equipment and the ham shack set behind me. Keep that going. So, okay. So meanwhile, there's Hamlet. Yeah, we need some pictures of this.
Yeah, I do need to be better at that.
Cause that would be cool.
We have a great, we actually have a great station there. The museum itself, the roof of the museum is about 35 feet high, and we were able to put a 30-foot tower on top of that, and we have a tri-bander on top of that. And, man, it's really a great, great setup.
I have seen a few ham radio stations at various museums. Some have been very successful. Some of them have been difficult and have had trouble. Probably the biggest problem that anybody who's running a station like that has is staffing it. How much time do you spend open for the museum?
You know, we are not open as often as I'd like, but, I do have a couple other guys who are regulars down there and, you know, we're doing okay. One of the big problems we have there now is noise, ambient noise, electrical noise too, but ambient, because we're right downtown in Ann Arbor. So there's lots of electrical noise, but ambient noise. And so we're working on a way to sort of close off the shack. I mean, and you don't want to close it off too much because then it doesn't let people come in, but close it off so that it's a quieter location. You know, if you're down there for like an hour and a half, the level of noise in that area is so high, it's just like overwhelming. And especially we have a lot of the other guys are older operators, and you know they have hearing problems. And one guy who helps us with the antennas all the time, he never comes down to operate because he gets down there and he can't hear anything because there's just so much ambient noise.
Yeah, at remote stations, I guess in some cases are helping out with things like that, and they you can almost make it look like a regular operating station because
yeah,
like Elecraft has a control panel, it looks like a radio.
Yeah, and we're thinking about doing that. Actually, we were thinking of making that station remotable, so I could operate from here in my home, or other people could actually operate it from there at their home. But then if you do that, it's sort of like things going on without anybody there to explain. Yeah, so you know what I'm saying. Yeah. It's tough. It's a tough thing. But we do have, like I say, we do have a you know some guys, and we're always working to get more interested and. Yeah, it's fun. They let us do our classes there too, so that's another nice thing about that.
So one of the things that I noticed when I was looking at a station, one that had closed down in Charlotte at a science museum called Discovery Place, mm-hmm. It had been operating for a long time, and then they did some rebuilding and had to shut things down to do some reconstruction. And decided not to put the ham station back in. And I think it was in part because it wasn't open all the time.
The museum folks decided that.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. The hams wanted to keep it going, but the hams also did not support it well enough to have it fully staffed all the time. But yeah, I did
that
have
happened on Long Island too.
Yeah, I did have a chance to at least observe the operation there at some. One of the things that I noticed was it is difficult to talk to the general public about ham radio.
Well, yes and no. When the people come up to me at the museum, they often will say something like, my dad did this, or my uncle did this, I had a neighbor that did that. And so then I talked to them about that.
Yeah, you know, if everybody who had a grandfather, a neighbor, or a parent who was a ham, we would have had 40 million hams in this country. Pretty
yeah.
sure.
Yeah.
Okay, but so what do you do? How do you talk to them?
Okay, so what I do is I say, well, you know, we talk to people all over the world here, and right near our operating position, there's a railing, and along that railing, we have a bunch of QSL cards. So I show them the QSL cards. We also have a map that's close, and we put little dots on the map when we talk to new countries. So I show them the map. And I think if anybody's shows a little bit of interest, I think they get it when I tell them, you know, what we're about here. And so I don't have that particular problem at the museum.
How about the other folks that you have helping you out? Do you do a course with them in how to talk to the public, or is everybody kind of on their own?
Nah, everybody's kind of on their own, but they're good. You know, to be honest, the Hands-On Museum is kind of a kids' museum, and actually that's the worst problem. It's really geared more toward 10 and under, and you know you only start getting ham radio when you're 10 and over, right? So that's kind of a little bit of a problem, but. The other guys are actually better with kids than I am. So I know it's kind of bad. And I almost hate to admit that on a show like this, but they're better at kids than I am. So that works out. We all do things a little differently, but we're all good with the public. And like I say, those guys are better with kids even. So,
well, hams have proven themselves to be really bad with kids. Cause I'll listen to things like Joda, the Boy Scouts thing. Kids Day and other activities where hams are supposed to talk to kids and get them engaged, and they are tongue-tied. They don't know what to say.
Well, the thing you do there is you ask them questions. You say, you know, like, what's your favorite color, or what's your favorite, you know, so I've learned these things over the years. Yeah, what's your favorite subject at school, that kind of thing. Joda, I have a good Joda story. We had some scouts in for Joda one year, and one of the kids was a ham already. And we happened to make contact with some scouts in Mexico City. And this kid was taking Spanish in high school, and he was a very smart kid. He talked to those scouts in Mexico City for about 45 minutes in Spanish. And that was really great. I mean, I didn't have to do anything. He just got on the radio and did everything.
Yeah, well, it was a harmonic convergence. You just got lucky.
I was lucky.
Yeah, but most of the time it's more awkward. And I did an interview with a 5-year-old ham, and I'm thinking, don't ask stupid questions. And I ask stupid questions. I tried not to be condescending. I tried to bring him up a level and bring me not too many levels down so that we could meet somewhere in the middle. But it's not easy to do.
Yeah,
you got to kind of practice.
You know, and what happens in the museum too is there's so many different exhibits that, and you only get their attention for a short time unless they're truly interested in ham radio, and that's happened a couple of times. You don't want to get too deeply into it, right? You know, you just want to sort of tell them some things, feel them out, see how interested they are, and if they do show more interest, you know. Go a little deeper. One kid recently, he had two brothers, and he brought his brothers over, and I think he was the one that was really interested, but they were all really well behaved. They sat there while I called CQ, and then we were fortunate enough to hook up with a guy in Washington, I think, somewhere, and we were lucky that the signals were really good so that they could hear, you know, really well both ways, and the guy on the other end was really nice, was good with the kids. So that was really good. I mean, that happens sometimes. That sort of makes the rest of it worthwhile, because I think that kid is certainly going to remember ham radio.
Yeah. Do you find the thing that many people report about kids and ham radio in a museum or just about any place? If you've got a little demonstration set up, they gravitate to the Morse code key.
Oh, you know what I do with that? So we actually have a Morse code demonstration there, and. What I'll do, and what I do in general when I do ham radio demonstrations, is I have a key set up, and I try to get them to send their name. So I'll say, okay, what's the first letter in your name? And they'll say, you know, M, say. So I show them on the chart. It says, okay, M is da-da, so send that, and they'll send that. I'll say, okay, that's good. Now send the rest of your name. So if, let's say the girl's name was Mary. So you know, she'll look it up, and then she'll send dit da, and then she'll look it up, dit da dit, and why da 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 da. I'll say, oh, hi, Mary, nice to meet you. And she'll say, well, how do you know my name? And I said, well, you just told me your name.
Yeah.
So I'll do that sometimes. And yeah, they do, you know, and because it's, you know, it's just something different, something cool.
Kids can be easy, can be very difficult.
So, that's for sure.
You got to kind of read them and see which way things are going.
Yeah, that's all for right. Sure.
Well, so we've got, I don't know if they start out with Morse code like that, with that fascination, I don't know where we lose them.
Well, yeah, you know, well, there's lots of different things for them to do, right? So yeah. that's the deal.
Yeah. Well, even once they get into ham radio.
But
maybe, you know, assuming that they do, and we're not trying to make everybody who comes to a museum or whatever into a ham, but we want to get those guys latent interest and do as much as we can with it if they've got it. So I guess once they do get interested in ham radio and had that CW thing in the background, what we're going to do is give them the CW Geek's Guide to Having Fun with Morse Code. For Barnes & Noble Nook or a whole bunch of other things. That's just what happened to pop up on the screen. So that is your book, Dan Romanchik. Did I hang on to that right?
KB6NU.
Good luck with the book. That's ham radio books are not your livelihood. But I was looking at your website for a little bit on this this thing where it says hire me. So We'll give you this little plug here.
Thank you.
what do people want to hire you for? Technical writing?
Yeah, mostly I'm a professional writer. I also do some websites, but I'm a professional writer. I used to write for it's kind of a funny story in a way. I used to write for a magazine called Test and Measurement World.
How I wrote exciting! All about the thrilling world of test and measurement.
I used to write all about electronics test and measurement. I used to write, you know, things like how to use an oscilloscope and electromagnetic compatibility testing and stuff like that.
Hey, somebody's got to do it.
Yeah, somebody's got to do it. It might as well be me.
So what are you looking to do these days? Are you freelance, totally freelance?
Yeah, I'm totally freelance. Actually, I'm looking to actually do more books because they are getting to be a little bit bigger percentage of my income. And I figured if I had 10 books out now, I could almost support myself on them.
Wow. I'm in the wrong business. I'm trying to do a television show and I'm, you know, Ham Radio Now brought in like $7,000 worth of contributions last year, not including the Tapper DCC. Most people who do a little blog or even a YouTube show would say $7,000. That is nothing to sneeze at.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
And you know, for the folks that have made contributions, bless you, people. But it is not a living. You know, you're not going to keep food on the table for doing that. So stuff.
The way I look at it, you know, Gordon West makes a living at it, right? So I should be able to make a living at it.
Yeah. Well, I hope you can. I hope someday I can. Don't do a television show.
Somebody once compared me to Gordon West, and they said something like, oh, yeah, next to Gordon West, he's the next best, or something like that, you know? I said, well, if I had to be compared to someone, Gordon West is – if I had to be number two to someone, Gordon West is
– Yeah, Gordon has the reputation, and he fulfills it, but he has to maintain such a character to be able to do that. And, you know, yeah. I've talked to Gordon in person when we're not on camera and stuff, and he is not the goofball in person that he is so much on in person at Hamfest doing talks and on Ham Nation and stuff. Yeah. Where I like to refer to Gordon as the lovable goofball, but it's a tough act to keep going.
Yeah, he's a great guy though. I mean, and you know, talking about guys that have really helped ham radio. I mean, with his study guides and with his class, all teaching all the classes he does, he's done a great job, and you know, I can only hope to do something similar here in Michigan.
Yeah, and he has brought in a lot of people to ham radio, and you have brought in a lot of people to ham radio. I probably brought in over the course of my 50 years in hamming, a dozen or so direct reports. You know, folks that I'm the one that inspired them, and who knows from the radio, from the TV show. I get email now and then from folks that say, wasn't a ham, but I'm going to become one because it looks like you guys are having so much fun. But you brought in a lot.
Well, I try. So. You know, it's making this tech study guide for free has really, really been something I did right. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and that's I mean, that's a labor of love at that point.
Yeah.
So because people can download the PDF, that is free on your website.
Right.
And if that's the way that works for you and it gets you where you need to go, you're all set. If for some reason that's not the way to go, you got some other options, bunch of other options.
Right.
So you can give that all a try. Well, thank you, Dan. I really appreciate you being on here with me.
My pleasure.
I'm going to wrap up the show here. I've done the plug for Arvin back there, but I always try to finish up the show the same way. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. HamRadioNow.tv. Click on Arvin. Send me some money. This year, maybe I'll do just slightly better than $7,000. I'm not expecting you to know how Ham Radio Now concludes the program, but I always give my guests the opportunity to be part of the conclusion of the show. And it is from the old Dick Tracy thing. The phrase is over and out. And so I will say, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and you get to say...
KN4, this is KB6NU, over and out.
You did the whole thing all by yourself. I don't get any part of it. Thank you, Dan. Bye-bye.
My pleasure. Really, it was fun.